Okay, well, you know what? We will get started. And this is like my first fail. So the first thing you learn in any children's ministry is that your list of fails goes like from 1 to like 683 in one morning some days, right? But it's okay because we're dealing with kids. And kids, they don't know the difference.
They don't.
They're just glad not to be in big church with their parents. And they're holding out that you're going to have some kind of treats in your classroom. That's usually what it is. So in my church, we actually have a hallway. So every time the kids come down and are dismissed from the service, they walk into our hallway and they never know what they're going to meet. So I always start in the hallway because I find if I can get them quiet there, because their parents are listening right there. And we don't want your parents to hear and think that you guys are misbehaving, because then you may not get to go play after lunch. You're going to go home and eat and probably have to stay in your room. So let's let our parents know by how quiet we are in using our indoor voices. So I have them meet outside, and this is one that I did just last Sunday. We're working through Exodus. So the kids all arrived and I had them all sitting down because we just had this big long walk through the desert. It was crazy, it was hot, we were hungry, we were cold, and it was just so great to see how God provided all of our needs. Just when we thought things were good, we show up and we're at the river. And it's like, well, this can't be where we're going to settle. This isn't what God had planned for us. It can't be. All of a sudden, we hear the roaring coming down from behind us, and they're looking, and the kids are like, what's going on? And you're like, don't look now, but I see chariots and horses. And they're like, where? And you're like, okay. And they're like, what are we going to do? And we're like, oh, no. We're like, this is it for us. We're going to like, right? And you're like, don't worry. Because Moses was under control. Moses knew that he had God on his side, and he was calm, and with maybe some of all the fails that they had experienced along the way, he knew one thing was certain. He could trust God. And so he raised his staff, and then I would have volunteers on each side. So maybe I can have you hold this side here, and you hold this side here. And if you want to come inside and you want to hold this side, uh-huh. And yes, you over here, and you're going to hold this side, and you're going to get some little parent volunteers or somebody, and you're going to be like, and then Moses raised his staff, and you're going to lift, and you're going to part the Red Sea, and you're going to have water bottles on this side spraying the kids as they're walking through, and now they're going through, and they're like, oh, this is crazy. How could this ever happen? This God must be amazing. So now they pass through, and the chariots are still coming. But again, Moses raised his staff, and God closed the sea, killing them, so we would never have to wait for or worry about them again. And now we're on this side, nice and safe. Come on in, ladies. You won't drown. You can doggy paddle in. Awesome. All right, come on in and have a seat, ladies. You know what? This is kind of cool because it's kind of like a girls' club. Well, with the exception of our visitor here who is going to be recording. I have to apologize. First of all, I forgot my glasses. So I'll see if these work. Second of all, I don't do handouts. And the reason I don't do handouts, and I hope you're okay with that, is because I like the eye contact, the interaction. There are no tables anyways for you to be writing. And if there's any important information that you really super want, I would rather talk to you on the phone or Skype or email or something. Okay, so we have just under an hour now. And I want to introduce myself. So my name is Michelle Reda. I am the full-time children's ministry director at a little church way out in Little St. Thomas, which is close to Lake Erie, Port Stanley. And I'm going to see if these work. They're actually very good. and they're really quite cute. Right? They're really cute. You must be in children's ministry. So I have been doing children's ministry for 13 years. Before that, I did 17 years of youth ministry. God has a sense of humor because I don't even like children. I shouldn't say that now. But 13 years ago, when my pastor approached me and said, Michelle, have you ever thought of changing direction in your ministry? I'm like, don't even talk to me about it. I'm comfortable where I am, and I'm good. And I think they think I'm good, and I think we're all good. So I didn't want to like uproot and start changing my way of thinking or anything. Now, I did have a few kids of my own, and I did like them. And then I had a few more kids of my own, and they were good too, so we hung on to them. So I have five of my own kids, and then I have two foster kids. And when I say foster kids, I'm not being honest. They're really not foster kids. They're foster adults. So they're kids that have come into our care very, very young, and they are now very big and very old, 26 and 28 years old, and they just won't leave our house. And I stopped cooking with cheese, and that doesn't work.
And so you're only 16.
I'm only 16. I love you. I love you.
13 years of this and 17?
I know. Okay, so because there's no real men here, because we're just pretending. We're just pretending. I'll tell you, so I'm 47 years old. I know, I look 18. I have a 21-year-old daughter, and a lot of people think we're sisters. Actually, the funny thing is that when we go out as a family, people quite often, my husband's a pastor, and they're like, hey, Pastor Andre, how's it going? And if they're meeting his family for the first time, he'll say, well, this is my oldest, Michelle, and then this is Carly. And they're like, oh, you have lots of kids. And I'm like, I'm not his oldest. I'm his wife, and I keep him in check. And so we can get away with it sometimes, but people who know me know that God wired me differently. So the beauty, the looks, I know I've got it all. No. But it's all going to catch up one day, and I'm going to enjoy it until it does. And you have to have that mindset when you're in kids' ministry, because they're going to suck the life out of you, and you have to have a lot of it to give, right? Yes, it is. It is. Okay, so I did do notes because I do tend to get a little dramatic and a little, and I could be teaching that class down the hall there and leave you guys and I wouldn't even know, because I do have ADHD, and a couple of my own kids have it, and so I try to stay focused with some of the tools I've learned, and so I'm going to try to practice that today. It's a relatively new thing for me. One of the things is having this little podium so that I'm not taken off down the hallway to see what they're serving. Rather, I'm here focused on my beautiful notes that I worked very hard on, which I always have to do because otherwise I get off course. So the success to any kind of children's ministry is being organized the best you can, because our brains are just nuts. And so when my pastor approached me and said, can you do kids ministry? I said, what? He said, no, I'm being serious. I'm going, you're nuts. He's like, no, really? I'm like, shut up, right? And that's the youth coming out, right? The youth talk. And then I'm like, well, Pastor, I'm going to do it. And then I'm going to go pray about it, because I'm doing it out of obedience, but I know I am not cut out for this, so I'm going to go and I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to, usually it's the reverse. It's, you know what, let me pray about it and I'll get back to you. But God doesn't call us to pray about it and then go. God wants us to go. He says, go. You go. We'll pray about it. We'll take care of it. We'll give you the tools. We'll give you what you need, the gifts. All that stuff will develop along the way. But I need you to go and bring the message to these children. So I jumped in with my little size 6.5 boots. And I was like, okay, let's do it. What are we going to do? And the very first thing that happened was I inherited a really super awesome three teachers. And I was like, you guys are great. Where's the rest of you in this great big church? And that's what I had to work with. The other thing is when I sat down with my teachers and I said, okay, guys, we're here. Here we are. Just like you guys here. Okay, so here we are. We've got kids ministry. I'm new. Where do we start? And the very first thing they said was, we're tired. Then they said, we're tired of this curriculum. So I come from a Christian Reformed church that has done gems and cadets since the people who are like 90 something in our church started when they were kids. In that time, I've come to learn that I think their curriculum has changed once. It has improved the graphics somewhat. Right? So the material is the same, but as far as the vision and the material, it was like, okay, I've never seen anything like this, actually, because their curriculum would arrive in three big boxes. And then it would be, why don't you all come over to my house and we'll sort. So here they are now, sorting out the take-home cards, sorting out the different grades. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? Yeah. And it was crazy. So here I am cross-legged going, whoa, okay, guys, wait, we need to stop. Don't take any more out of the box. Like, this is insane when we have the internet and we've got magazines, and we've got, like, there's all kinds of stuff. This is, like, a little insane here, and I'm a little overwhelmed. So the first thing I thought was, oh, I have a really big task. I need to hear my teachers and make my teachers happy, because you have no program without your teachers. Second one was, I gotta take on my church leadership now. Woo! Yes! So, called up my pastor and said, I need to be at the next board meeting. So I went to the board meeting and I said, I'm only here to ask for permission to review other material. That's it. I'm not here to say we're not gonna do ours, but I just wanna see what's out there. I got the go-ahead, a lot of restrictions, but needless to say, the leadership took an initiative and put together a team for me so that I didn't have to have the burden of making the wrong choice. It would be on their shoulders. So we started investigating. We called around to other churches. We did church visits, me and my little posse of three, in my little minivan, french fries on the floor, away we go. And it was like amazing to sit down and be encouraged by other churches. But then it got a little overwhelmed because we are just a little church with, I think on an average Sunday now, we have about 135 kids. So it's 135.
Children.
Children. 135
children.
Oh, you're in Toronto, people.
Why we have
nine. Children.
Really? Oh. Oh boy. We're gonna fix that. I might have to stray from this and we're just gonna fix that right now.
People in the whole church.
Okay, so I oversee. So that's infant to grade five. So I oversee infant to grade five. And then we have our junior high and a senior high, and I kick them out the door and they go off to the youth pastor, and I don't have to deal with that anymore. So we got together and we had a couple of curriculums and we looked at them and we thought, what are some key elements? Well, my leadership's going, well, we don't know what your key elements really need to be because we don't teach it. And I thought, that's great. Neither do I. But as a mom, what do I want my 5+ kids to be learning when they go off for an hour down? Because I'm going to tell you, as busy as our lives get, and this is just an awesome, not awesome, sorry, an honest reality, we do depend on our Sunday school to feed our kids. As much as we not ought to, and as much as we need to be instilling that in everything they do all week, and whether they're in Christian school or in public school or youth groups or just different events, care groups, life groups, whatever, we do kind of hope they're going to get that little, so what story did you learn today? Tell it to mommy, because mommy doesn't know it. Right? And so that's kind of what we ran into. So we came up with a few little curriculums, and when we went through some of them, they were all super cool. The box that this one came in was so awesome. The goodies that came in that one were super sweet. And then the other one, well, easy, easy peasy. So my first thing was, I'm gonna go with easy because I need to recruit my teachers. So we went with Faith Weaver. That was, for 11 years now, we've actually been using Faith Weaver, and I know some people think, 11 years? But they just came off of doing 800 years of Faith Alive, so I'm okay with 11. Actually, yes.
Who's the publisher of that?
So group publishing. Is anybody here familiar with group publishing? VBS is, right? I'm the VBS queen. We'll connect. Honestly, it's the best. That's my favorite part of kids' ministry. Woo! Okay, so group publishing here in Canada. I have been their ambassador now for 4 years. It started because I just picked up the phone and I said, hey, how's it going? And they answered the phone, it's a great day, Group Canada. And I became a best friend with Dawn on the other end. Until 2 or 4 years ago when I finally got to meet her at a conference. It's like, Dawn, it's a great day here in Ontario. I'm so glad you're here. And over the years, I said to her, you know what? What will it like? I want your job. I want your job, Dawn. I want to have a great day, group, every day. How do I get your job? So it wasn't long before she said, can you do a video? And I'm like, what? No. Like I said, I don't do the mics. Video? No. So I said, well, okay. So we videotaped me teaching a Sunday school classroom and sent it off. And within a week, they're like, we want you. And I'm like, yes, I want you. Can I move? Oh, it's Winnipeg. Yeah. What can I do in Ontario? So this is what I'm doing in Ontario now. So just because I'm a group representative, though, does not mean that I use all group stuff. I use what works for my church. I use what's going to grab the attention of my kids. And I'm going to share with you now what I, the things that I look for. So, and this has been actually, it's interesting because even though these are the things I looked for, group actually has this in terms of they use this example of how they base all their curriculum from children to women's ministry, men's ministry, pastoral level, everything. And that is that they keep it real. And when they say real, and these are the things that apply to me, and I get to stick to my notes so I don't get sidetracked. I'm already like on page 8. Where is it? Actually, let me backtrack a little bit. When we talk, I want to talk, because my workshop, and I just had to throw a title on it, but my workshop was choosing the right curriculum. And we probably come from different denominations, I'm thinking. And so sometimes we might be restricted, and sometimes we may have a little bit more freedom. I know that it wasn't my first choice to use denominational material, and I was very nervous going outside of it, because I really wanted to still promote the values that our denomination promotes. But then I had to think, and I had to challenge my counsel on how important is curriculum? And it's funny because they're up there going, well, yeah, it's got to be pretty important because, you know, you're teaching it to the kids and you want it to be fun and engaging. And I went, whoa, no. Actually, my curriculum that I'm teaching in kindergarten and in nursery school is the only curriculum in our church that everybody in our church is getting. Everyone. It's the only curriculum. So you can preach all you want. And they're great, but you're not reaching my kids with your messages. You can do your women's studies and your coffee break time, but those are not reaching my kids. But my kids are learning stories, and they are learning Bible truths, and they're sitting at the dinner table now with their moms and their dads, and now they're talking to grandma because grandma brought something up, and they're saying, grandma, guess what I learned about Moses today? Our curriculum reaches the entire church. And so going in with that idea, I had to think, now my curriculum has to have elements that is going to be appealing to everybody in my church. It has to be something that the kids aren't just going to hear it and they forget it when they leave the door. So we've adopted this real example. Real meaning relational. And I'm just going to read out just so that I stay on track here with you guys. So relational is where kids are working together with one another, practicing the activities or the tools that stimulate their memory work and making it much easier to retain. So when they come through your door and you're meeting them out there and you're like, good morning, what's your name?
Daniel,
good morning, high five, buddy, how's it going? I bet you're wondering what's going on here. Yeah, guess what, I'm not gonna tell you, but you're gonna figure that out soon because I'm gonna need your help and you're gonna help me do this, and boom. Now I've just built a relationship with Daniel and he's just visiting for the very first time. I've never met you, have I? Have I met you before?
So.
You wish you had, don't you? Yes, I'll take you to McDonald's later. So you've just connected with a kid, right? So they're coming in. So now you're like, okay, so we're gonna have the Israelites over here. You guys are all the Israelites. High five each other. Okay, and you guys are the Egyptians over here. High five Egyptians. Well, Egyptians would probably put you in a little head knock box or something. And so you want them to practice amongst each other now. So they're making now, high five, body contact, without actually hugging and going places they don't need to go, right? But they're letting you know that, hey, I like you and I'm gonna touch you, I'm good, right? So that's what we want. We want our kids to be able to interact, not just with teachers, but with the kids in their classroom. So I wanted a curriculum that is gonna have kids up and running around and engaging and not being afraid that they might say something wrong or do something wrong. Yes?
Can I just interrupt for one sec? How much time have you got with the kids?
It varies on how long our congregational prayer goes. Because if it's a long doozy, it's usually 40 minutes.
Okay, so 40 minutes at the most?
Yeah, unless I have something super special and please, Pastor Greg, can you like do the offering right off the top and then dismiss the kids because I just really, really, really need them for a whole hour today. But they're pretty flexible that way. We do have a little bit of room. But then last week we had 4 baptisms. So we had about 20 minutes. So then what am I gonna do? Well, I just put all this work into building the Red Sea and Mount Sinai. So, by the way, just so you know, this took me 3.8 minutes. That actually took me a little longer. But this, I'm not even kidding. I'm gonna talk about that in just a minute. So real, relational. The next one is E, experiential. And I can't even really say that really well, but experiential, right? Experience, yeah, it's not experiment, experience. And what that is, it's where kids are working together with one another, practicing activities or tools that stimulate, I already read that one to you, that was the wrong one, allows kids to learn the lesson by experiencing God's word lived out. So now I've got my Egyptians, I've got my Israelites, I've got Moses, or I might have Samson, I might have and I'm going to put like a hula skirt on his head, he's got his long hair, and but you were Samson when you were a baby, so you're in a diaper, and here's a baby bottle. Or I might have, I want you up on a chair because you are Goliath, and you're Daniel down there, so get down really, really low. And they're experiencing it, right? They're living it. I got to be Goliath today. Oh, I would have like killed them all, Mom. It was like, right? Because that's what they're thinking. But then you're like, but yeah. And little David came and he threw this little paper rock at me and I was done, right? So, but they're learning it and you're engaging with them. And you've got a kid standing on a chair, which at home his mom would say, get off that chair. So now you've got a kid who can't wait to come to your classroom because he gets to stand on tables and chairs and jump around and be crazy, right? Talk about SpongeBob, talk about things that, you like that stuff? I get to sit on a chair. I have the best Sunday school teacher in the world. Okay, the next one is applicable. It's an action or a skill that is teaching children to relate in a way they can retell the story to others. They are learning to become doers of the word. So you want me to repeat that? You guys are taking notes, I feel bad. No, I didn't have handouts. So, applicable is an action or skill that is teaching children to relate in a way they can retell the story to others. They're learning because, or, and they become doers of the word. So now, here they're sitting in a playground, and so-and-so just whacked so-and-so with their lunch bag, and he's like, you shouldn't be doing that. Why not? Well, because you know, you're bigger than him. And I know that there's this guy named Goliath, and yeah, he thought he was pretty tough too, but this little guy, David, took him out. So you should watch out what's going on, you know, you never know. And I mean, I don't know how kids retell stories, but they always embellish things and they create their own stuff. But the child is now telling someone else about it. So he's discipling, he's doing what God told him to do. And it might just be one little thing, but that's just amazing. Go home and say, oh man, yeah, got a detention because I hit so-and-so with my lunch bag, but I know it was wrong, Mom. I know it was wrong. And so there's an impact out there to be made, and kids impress kids. Yeah. Kids have permission to impress kids. Kids have this trust that can reach kids, a trust we don't have. I don't even have with my own kids. They would rather talk to somebody else their age than to their parent. And you know what? And that's good. We pray for that. We pray that our kids will have people come into their lives, whether small, medium, or large, and they are invested in, and they love it. And you know what? You want your kids to have that go-to person whenever they can. I'm doing pretty good without your glasses because, see how big I wrote it? I printed that at my mother-in-law's. I'm like, Mom, I didn't bring my glasses. Can I print this? Okay, so the L in real is learner-based. Now, this is really super important because you want to make sure that they're learning your stuff. You want to make sure that the time that you're pouring into preparing for your lesson is going to be worth your time because you're busy. You got kids. You got to bake for the potluck that day. You've worked full time all week and you had to go to a meeting. So how are you going to do, like, you know what I mean? It's and I'm the same way. I'm a busy mom. I do this, I this, I this. And then, oh, guess what? I got a call at 7 o'clock in the morning and Mike can't make it because his little one has the flu. All right, okay, well, I was at the dollar store the other day for Everest for our VBS and I had leftover tablecloths. Okay, all right, this is what I need you guys to do. I need you now to put the tablecloths together. This is what happened last week, exactly. So I had a couple of the youth I pulled out. I'm like, I need you to staple these together, put the rope together. I'm not sure how this is gonna work, but just kind of work with me for a minute, but we only have like literally 15 minutes before the kids are dismissed. So boom, the kids did this. I was like, you rock. This stuff here, these are like from 8 years ago from one of our VBSs. I keep everything. I'm a pack rat. Dollar store right here. Stole this off the piano in the sanctuary today. Right? And underneath it, believe it or not, is a Rubbermaid box, a chair, a whole stack of chairs that was in the cupboard, and the lamp from the table. So it was like, and I knew that going into that, there'd be something in the church I can go and steal, right? And to do that. So you're draped and boom, 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 done. Okay, and everything fit back in my Rubbermaid box. Love it. So keeping things learner-based. And learner-based is offering a variety of activities to meet where each kid is at, intellectually, spiritually, and physically. Every child, and I know this personally because of my ADHD, Every child learns differently. Every child needs to be encouraged, and every child needs to feel like they're in a safe place. So as nervous as I was showing up here, because I was at another event last night till 10:30 in London, which is 2.5 hours from here, jumped in my car last night, got in at midnight, my in-laws slept, got up this morning, scooted over, I was running late, and I was like, I am so nervous. And I walked to the front door, and there was a lovely registration lady, and I'm like, I'm here, where do you want me? And it took me 20 minutes just to get to this room because I had to hike around, because they're like, the door over in the end will be open because you can't go through the sanctuary. They're in session. So that's why I was pretty late. But you know what? I felt safe. I felt like, you know what? Everybody is here for the same thing. Everybody loves Jesus. Everybody loves kids. And everybody is about teaching kids to tell people how to love Jesus. How can we be wrong with that? Honestly. So you want to have something in your class now that's going to stimulate little Seth, because Seth is a redhead, first of all, so that just explains a lot, but he's wired, right? He's just, woo! I don't know if his mom and dad give him like sugar corn pops for breakfast, I don't know, but I've got Seth here, and then I've got Sydney, and Sydney is a foster kid who comes to, with her foster parents, and just came off of a weekend visit with her parents, her biological mom. So I've got some little issues right happening there. And then I've got Damien over here, whose parents just buzzed his head with cute little designs for Halloween in it, and he's a little self-conscious about that. Are they gonna make fun of me? So then I've got other kids who have learning disabilities. I have kids who are extremely shy. Oh, and let's not forget Michaela, who I'm literally have to pry her fingers off to get her away from Mummy. So who's screaming now in my classroom, right? So you've got this mixture of kids, and you may only have those five, or you may have a classroom of like 15 or 20. Regardless, you're gonna be spending most of your time, if you're not prepared and have the popular curriculum, babysitting and discipline. Stop that, don't make me raise my voice. I've been talking all night, do not make me raise my voice. You're gonna go have to sit in that chair over there, Damien. Please, please just listen to me this once. And halfway through the class, I have not even gotten to the craft, and that's all they care about at that time. Are we doing our craft? And what's the snack? So, I don't want them going home saying, look what we made, Mom, boom, it's on the van floor. I have got about 6 months of take-home paper on my van floor. Yeah. Doesn't make it in the house, and I'm not gonna lie, but I mean, I think I have the best curriculum out there, and it still is not making it. So, I'm gonna get to that too. Anyhow, so you wanna have a curriculum that has activities that are gonna engage, that are gonna stimulate, and that are gonna just wow certain kids at certain areas. So you might have Damien here, who's like, he's the craft guy, he's a hands-on, fidgety, I gotta do it. Sydney, you know what, Sydney, I really need you to be my helper and focus on me today. So you're gonna be Princess Sydney. And do you know why you're a princess? Because your Heavenly Father is a king. So you're gonna be a princess. So she's gonna come up and she's gonna hand out all my scissors and all my things. Thank you, Sydney, I couldn't do it without you. And then it's gonna be Seth, don't make me tell you again, because if I have to tell you again, I am going to make you Rebecca. Okay, so you know you want to have different things that are going to be like, huh? Because you've got the material to actually do that now. I've got a super awesome craft, I've got a super awesome story, and I need material to make my Bible lesson come to life. So you want to have all of that learner-based, can I take it, how do I adjust, what do I do? So we settled on Faith Weaver. Faith Weaver, and I wish I had a box with me, and I didn't even bring one up because they're all on my table, but stop by and you can see that. Now, why did I choose Faith Weaver over many curriculums? Well, let me tell you, the biggest church in St. Thomas, Faith Baptist, I'm best friends with the children's ministry director there. She does three curriculums. Yeah, so she does hands-on Bible, this one here, with her little ones, her teeny little kindergartners. Preschool. She does the 2-5-2 basics with her, I guess, 1-3-ish. And then she does grapple for what they have, kind of like their transitioning age into junior high. And I said to her, Lisa, this is insane. Are you not exhausted every quarter having to reorder and make sure you have the proper teacher books there, you've got your student books there, you've got your take-home papers there, you've got your connect sheets for your parents, like there's so much information, are you not just like on information overload? And you know what, she's like, yeah, I know, And it's just because she just doesn't know any there. She hasn't taken the time to figure out what works the best. So she's kind of making everybody happy. Well, this is easy for you. That's easy for you. And you know what you're doing because you've been here longer than me. So we're all good. So if it is, well, me, that would drive me up the wall. And so I'm going to take these off. One thing that they teach you with Group Canada is not to be distracting when you're public speaking. Okay. Oh, I'm so hot. Just kidding. It's that, you know, that age, right? Okay. So I'm looking at Faith Weaver. Faith Weaver had R-E-A-L. I was like, that's amazing. Can my teachers teach this stuff? Well, let me tell you, I think I have an example. I do, okay. So an example lesson, I didn't bring the whole book because my other teacher who's supposed to be teaching tomorrow has the book, but I photocopied the Ten Commandments. So kids have come through. The Ten Commandments is actually done in two weeks because it's just so amazing, so big as part of life challenges. So they learn about the whole coming through the Red Sea and what that all meant in terms of trusting God. Then what happens again? Well, they goof up and want to do their own little thing and they start a party right at the base of the mountain again with the shaking, crazy mountain in the background. So your teacher calls you up and says, hey, Michelle, my daughter has a fever of 183. I cannot make it in. I'm so sorry. And I'm like, hey, no problem. I wasn't going to go to church today, but I am now. Just kidding. So I go online because Faith Weaver has a digital element to it as well. So I'm like, I remember I sent the link to somebody. I've got to find it now. Who did I send? Yes, there it is. Karen's got it. Boom. Okay, date. Yes, there I am. Here's the great thing. I'm just going to take you through this story, actually, so you'll see how easy it is because I haven't actually looked at this yet. Because I didn't really, I hadn't taught that part. I had just taught this part. So this is the part that she would be teaching tomorrow. This is actually from the pre-K. So we start, just so you know, I start Faith Weaver at infant. They have their infant kit. They have their, it's so amazing. And my volunteers in my infant room, which is our seedlings, they all got promoted. They are no longer babysitters. They are teachers. They are teachers of God's word. They've been empowered. They got new, beautiful, sparkly name tags. I have a couple of capes that I give to the leaders that I let the leaders wear on the first day. I have some real men of Jesus in the nursery room taking care of business, right? It's amazing. And that wasn't always, but it was selling them on something that made them think what you're doing now is of value. I'm going to give you something now that you can work with that is super easy, even for you dads. But I want to empower you to know that that hour you have with those little ones, you're humming, you're playing, you're stimulating, you're building trust. And this is that's the core beginning of it, right? That's the beginning. And it's training you, it's teaching you patience, kindness, love, right? All of that stuff. So we're learning as we're teaching all the time with Faith Weaver. So I walk into the classroom, beautiful Faith Weaver curriculum. If you look on this page, it says say.
I've got my glasses.
Oh, I do. It says say and ask all the time. Those are my two favorite words. Say and ask, right? So now I just open up the book. Hi guys, nobody knows that I just got out of bed 15 minutes ago. I'm here, and just so you know that if you're not called out 15 minutes before you need to teach, it only takes about 20 to 25 minutes to do this prep from beginning to end. Unless you're super creative and you now want to build Mount Sinai and you're searching your whole church for stuff. Don't ever take the baptismal font because, yeah, pastors need that. And when it's set up front, that usually means they're going to use it that day. So just be careful. Don't tell them I told you could take that stuff. Okay, so let's get to our overall. So what the curriculum does now is the curriculum is saying when the kids arrive to have some music playing and have a welcome song. There's a really cute welcome song, and I was singing it when you, the camera guy, kind of slipped out there because I have a horrible voice. My kids know I have a horrible voice. And I think the sooner you admit it, the easier life's going to be for you. So you have everybody coming in, and I am so glad that you are all here today, and I'm going to teach you all this fun little song that I just learned 5 minutes ago myself. It's so awesome. So I want you guys, who knows the song? And it tells you right here, put your CD on, and you're going to sing this song to the tune, do your ears hang low? So it tells me that. So I've got to go for a second. I got to go, do your ears hang low? Do they want, do they want? Okay, okay, okay. I got it. Okay, are you ready, everybody? Can you say, do your ears hang low? And they're like, do your ears hang low? And then I'm like, great, how about this now? Would you like to, oh, this is where I need the glasses. Sorry, it just went all in a blur. Okay, would you like to hear the Bible? Would you like to sing and pray? Would you like to be with friends on this very special day? And then you stop and you look at them and you're like, well, we'll come and join our circle and we'll hold our hands and say, we're so glad you're here. Right? Now, like I said, I sang it for the first time when he left to go to the washroom and or drink. But that was pretty good.
That was
right? Pretty good. Yeah. And you know why? Because you can't mess up with kids. You really can't. In fact, you guys have every right to be silly, to be creative, and to really mess up big time, because your pastor can't get away with that up on the pulpit. But you can, because they don't really know the difference. They think it's part of your whole plan. So you're good to go with that. So they have you welcome, and it says, welcome your kids. The next stage is it has the Faith Weaver key verse. You want them to take Bible truths home. You want them to learn it, memorize it, hide it in their heart, and then use it. Be the doer of the word. And so Faith Weaver, from infancy all the way up to pastoral level, I'm talking junior high, senior high, small group, that curriculum, if they're teaching it in my Seedlings class, it's the very same lesson they're teaching in my junior high class. It's the very same lesson that our care groups are doing this week. And now I've got moms and dads picking up kids in nursery, picking up kids in grade 3 and in grade 8. And now they're sitting down to have soup and buns, because it's a Dutch church. And they're talking about, what'd you guys learn today? Not, what did you learn today? How about you? What did you learn today? And what do you mean you didn't go? What do you mean grade 8? What do you mean you guys are playing hangman the whole time? Where was your teacher? Right? But now you're sitting at your table and your little one has just given you the first part of his verse, trust in the Lord. So you've got your little 2-year-old going, trust in the Lord. And then you've got your grade 1 going, oh, well, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And then you've got your grade 8 going, yeah, well, I did do my homework. So it's trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him and he will direct your paths. And so now your kids are all sitting at the table. You're going to practice that one verse all week, and you can relate to one another, right? And so that's the beauty I find using one curriculum. And I'm going to tell you something. Your curriculum has such an influence on the direction of your church. So if you are picking a curriculum that is broad, you will have broad-minded people. You will have people that are kind of just out there. If you have a specific, age-appropriate, intentional, Bible-believing curriculum, those are the disciples you're going to make. So you have to decide for your church, what do you want? And I know that when I went into my church, with having 3 teachers left to do that, I'm thinking, you guys have classes of 40 kids. It's no wonder everybody left, because you guys are, you're beating the kids up all hour, really. How do I get you guys from there to here? Okay, so I have 70 volunteers now, 70 teachers. I don't have any volunteers. I have 70 teachers. That is from my infants to my grade 5, including my special task team, who are, they're my people. They're my go-to people. They're the ones who kick me in the butt. They're the ones who challenge me. They're the ones who keep me on course. They're the ones who, I have a decorating lady who stimulates my mind. It's great. And it's for nothing other than they're excited about what we're talking about now. They're excited that in our curriculum, it's not just telling our kids to sit in a classroom when I'm going to talk to you the whole time. I want, you know what, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Let's talk about trust. So I can sit at my desk and I can have a thing of water and I can be like, if I pour this water into this cup and I got a big jug and a little cup, I bet you know what's going to happen, right? All that water in that little glass is going to what? It's going to flow over. It's going to overflow. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give everybody, and I should have brought it and did it with you guys, I'm going to give you all this little styrofoam cup, and I want you now to get a partner, and you're going to get another pitcher of water, everybody's going to get a pitcher of water, and you're going to put the cup on your head, and you're going to trust your partner now. She's the one going, I'll pour first. I love her. And you're going to now pour the water, and you're going to trust that your partner is going to stop just before you get drenched, right? And now some kids are going to fool around. Little Seth just can't wait till he gets to pour. But you're over there going, okay, Seth, now very carefully. They don't know when, they don't know if it's coming or not. And you're pouring. And kids are just sitting there some of them are get me wet, right? But they're sitting there. And it's that whole interacting now, that whole trusting. So now they're at home, they're like, Dad, sit down, put a cup on your head. The ice bucket challenge right here, right? But it's something that they're going to remember now because they got to do something a little silly, a little fun, and very risky. And so you're engaging, you're interacting, and our teachers are not just sitting at their little podium saying, okay, so Moses, where was I? Oh, yes. It's easier to keep God number one in your life, don't you agree? Oh, yes, it is, of course. And we tell kids that all the time, but you know what? Who's number one in your life? Stand up on your chair, and I want you to shout, God's number one. In fact, I want all you guys to stand up on your chairs over here, and I want all of you to stand up over there, and I'm going to come over here, and I brought my son's headphones, and I want to hear right now who thinks God's number one the most. And they're shouting it. Okay, stop. Sit down. Hands on under your bums. And they're quiet again. But they had that up down because kids don't sit still. So now you just let them all their energy, and now they get to just come back to, okay, let's talk about why God's number one. What are some things that might take us away from God being number one? Being bad, not reading our book, yes. What are some other things, though, that might distract us from God? How many of you have iPods? I do. I got mine right here. Give me that iPod. Right? Okay, so we've got iPods. We have video games. We have toys. We have friends. We have just stuff. We're on overload of taking our mind off the focus, and that's God's number one. And if we know that God's number one, all that other stuff is number two, number three, number four. You'll never go wrong with number one. Number one will always be with you. And so when your iPod screen cracks, you still got God. And when your toys are broken or somebody took your toy or you lost or left it in Florida in your hotel room, you still have God. He's still going to be number one. And I want you to hold up your number one finger and I want you to say, God is number one. And you're doing this with kids. And I'm not making this stuff up. It's all here. It told me to say that. It told me to ask the kids. Now, that's not the lesson that's here, but that's how this curriculum works. And so this curriculum is so full of stuff, and this is why I love it the most, because when we have four baptisms and I only have 22 and a half minutes or something, I can go through this and go, okay, I put time into the craft and I built my story. I'm just going to focus on that. And then I'm not sure how much time we'll have, so then I'll bring us together, and we circle up. So we circle up knee to knee. All right, everybody, come on, circle up. And I wait. Your knees have to touch. Touch. Come on, touch. Seth, get in here. Touch. Right? Okay. And then it's like, let's talk. Let's gab. Let's talk about what are some things this week that maybe distracted you from thinking that God was number one. And now, here's the other thing. You can be in your class with your preschoolers, and you can do the same thing. Why were you set? You have a boo-boo? Oh, how did that boo-boo make you feel? Can I kiss your boo-boo? Does it feel better? You know what? God loves you, and God would kiss your boo-boo too, right? And you're talking about trust. You just have to trust Him. Do you know it? Do you hear Him? But He's here. He's right here in your heart, right there, right? And you're getting down to their level, and you're building that relational part with them. And so they're feeling trust. They're feeling accepted. They're feeling it doesn't matter how goofy or how much my parents whacked me, from the front seat of the car on the way here. I'm here. My teacher loves me. My teacher's patient with me. And I'm telling you, it has nothing to do with me. It has to do with... this is why I don't do this stuff. It has to do, I hope I didn't break it, sorry. It has to do with being given the proper tools and using your imagination just even a little bit. You don't even have to be genius, and I'm not genius by any means, and I'm not usually a creative person, but something about when I get something that's easy, so it's taken the burden now off of me to have to go, 3 hours of home of prep time, and I just got this a half an hour ago, right? So if I have to sit here with the kids and say, okay, guys, so today our Bible story is And in at my table, I have a Theo puppet, actually. And I don't do Theo puppet voices very well, but I have some teachers who do very good Theo. They made him a little doghouse. They play the Theo song. Theo comes out. He's this big furry Theo, the Theopolis something or other. He's a puppy. So Theo comes out and he's like, hi, everybody. The teacher's like, hi, Theo. I could do the teacher, hi, Theo, but then changing that voice back and forth. I hid in the story surprise box. You did what? Right? And so you're having this conversation, you're engaging with little kids. Then you get up to some of the older grades and you've got your lesson and you're like, okay, so today we're going to talk about the story that we just, that off of what we learned last week. And who can remember what we talked about last week? Remember we were running from something. What were we running from? And you're engaging them again now back to going, oh yeah, we were running from the Egyptians. Now we're here. Now we're sitting at the base of this great big mountain and it's shaking and it's doing stuff and we don't know what to make of it. And so what do we do? And well, Moses again says, God has favored me. He's called me and he heads on up. And he's doing his thing with God, and they're having their little encounter and everything, and then Moses comes down, and the party's going on again, and let's see what that party might look like. I want to see everybody up and dancing. So now you've got some, like, grade threes, and they're doing the running man, and, you know, they're all, like, dancing. They're having a dance party. So you're engaging with them. So you're like, woohoo, and you're all out there, we're partying. This is great. Look at this great big cow we just built. It's awesome. And then Moses comes, and he is not happy. Everybody sit down right now. And they're like, boom, right? And then, so they had their up and down. So you've engaged them, you've become real. They've participated in your story. Now, there are a lot of curriculums that do that. There really are. And I'm going to tell you now the hard truth. You can get, first of all, you're in children's ministry because you love kids. Does anybody know what time it is? Is that why you're here? Is that your job? Okay, so you're here because you love children. You're here because you want to teach kids about Jesus Christ. You wouldn't be doing this because you don't get paid. I know that. Anybody here get paid? You're all volunteers? You guys are literally my heroes because I couldn't do what I do without my volunteers, without my leaders. You can take any curriculum. And if you love kids and you love Jesus, you can make that curriculum come to life. So it's not that you have to use my faith weaver because I just did this story and we built Mount Sinai and everything. You have to decide who you have as your core group. Who is your team? What is your team capable of? Are they capable of 3 hours? They might be a couple of sweet little seniors who just love doing this stuff and they've been doing it for so long that they know how to do it. And they're happy to do it and they're making their stuff come to life on Sunday morning and the little kids are high-fiving grandma as she's coming up the hall and you're getting those elements, right? The relational, the experiential, the applicable, the learning. You're getting all of that. So if I leave anything with you guys today, that's what I want you to concentrate on as far as curriculum goes. I want you to think about real. Is it real? And if you can open something up and look at it and go, for example, and I've messed my pages up, this is how simple it is for me, is that, Faith Weaver, these are the elements it has. So it has the getting started, the welcome song. So there's my reel. We're introducing each other. Sometimes I'll take a little bit of time to say, oh, we just got back from VBS or summer or whatever. Who wants to share something? And you give them permission now to become transparent. And you can tell who the kids that are feeling comfortable and trust. So not that you would ignore them, but you also know now that you've got some quiet kids that you might have to focus on a little bit. So that's a teller for you guys. Then my curriculum says, let's go over our key verse from last week. Let's check in with you guys and see what you remember from last week. Who can tell me? It was yes, that's right. Way to go. You guys are amazing. Well, this week I have a new one for you. And here's the deal. We've been doing 4 in a row now. That is 4 big memory verses. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to be standing at my door with a box of gummy worms. Next week when you come through, if you can tell me all 4, you get a gummy worm. If you can only tell me 1, I'll bite a piece off. You can have the rest, right? You want to motivate them. I'm the gummy worm queen. And sour keys. They love sour keys. But motivate them to be thinking about their memory work. I know some churches, they did their memory verse. There's your sticker. And at the end of the year, you have Abraham did 140 memory verses this year. He gets everybody. everybody in the church give him a round of applause. And there's little Abraham all proud. He hasn't played outside all summer, but he's good, right? Because he wanted the approval. So it depends on what works in your program. What does your church do to celebrate things like that? Then it goes on to the Bible exploration. I love it how they call that Bible exploration, because that's exactly what you want them to do. You don't want them to hear a story. You want them to be in it. You want them to live it. You want them to hear. You want the little tiny babies that you just photocopied or drew little lion's whiskers taped to the top of Tupperware containers, and you're talking about Daniel in the lion's den, and you've got these little babies now playing with these lids. Those are the lion's mouth. Look at them. They're coming after Daniel. And you know, so you're doing this, and they're playing, and they're engaging with you. And then you've built a den in grade 3, so the kids are coming into this den, and you've got volunteers that have, again, hula skirts, because hula skirts are great, on their heads to look like these lions roaring when these kids come in, right? So I'm telling you, I can give you the go-to list for the Dollarama. It's great, and they pack nice and small. But that's what you want to do. So let's explore. It says here, it says you can welcome for 10 minutes. You can spend 10 minutes on your memory verse. You can spend 15 minutes doing your Bible exploration. Then it has you doing what I love. This is probably my favorite part, is weaving it. It's here because I wrote it. Well, it's somewhere in here, but it's weaving it into life. Okay, let's talk about now, here it is. Let's talk about what we've just learned and how you're going to apply that this week. What's one thing that you're going to do? So if we're talking about trusting God, Moses told them over and over and over, and they didn't listen. They just weren't getting it. They're crazy. How do you, he fed us, he kept us warm, he said, and now he's giving us a set of rules to live by so that we're not lost, that we don't need to try to figure it all out ourselves. He's given us the best roadmap. How many of you guys have a roadmap in your glove compartment? You know what I want you to do? I want you to pull out your Bible, and if you don't have one, you come see me because I'll have one for you. But I want you to pull out your roadmap to life, and I want you to talk to your mom and dads, and I want you to say, Mommy, this is where God wants me to go. This is what God wants me to do. He's giving me direction. Or Daddy, pull out your roadmap. I want to see your roadmap. Here's my roadmap, Dad. Let's talk about it. So when we go to Florida, we're going this way and this way and this way. How do you know to go that way? Well, the map tells us. I know, but this is what my teacher told me today. My teacher told me that if I do this and I follow this way, that I'm going to be able to spend forever with Jesus in heaven. Like, how cool is that? So, you know what? It really is in your control as far as how you're going to engage with your kids. Downstairs at the table, I do have a whole array of curriculums that you're welcome to take a look at. But I have catalogs and stuff, too, that you can take with you. I didn't bring stuff to sell because I just don't. It's a lot of work. I just really wanted you guys to have a variety of different things that group puts out there, because group is aimed to meeting the needs to that Sunday school classroom of 3 kids or that classroom of 30 kids. I've met Joni and Tom Schultz. I see them in Chicago. I see them in Colorado when I go. They're amazing. And they are so in love with developing material to empower you and to not just to empower you, but to complement you. To compliment who you are. I have a teacher who loves to do the games. He is amazing. And then I have a little bit of an older teacher who's all about the story. And she's sweet too, but she's very quiet, and she's not the high-fiving kind that comes through the door. That's okay, because they're gonna get Mr. Vanderkoy next year, right? But it's all where you're at. If your curriculum is real, then you are engaging your kids, your family, yourself, and your teacher. Here's a key. You are what makes your children's ministry. You could have curriculum, you could have the best VBS, you could have the best helpers. You could have not the best helpers. You might have the most helpers. But if you walk into your job every day and you're like, oh, okay, what are we going to do today? Well, I got this new curriculum. We can take a look at it and see if it excites us. I think it'll be good. I think, you know what? No, it's really, really going to be good. I think it's awesome. And they're looking at your face saying, really? Because your face isn't telling us it's awesome. But if you're walking walking, and you're like, hey guys, sorry I'm late. I just had to go to Tim Hortons because I'm Canadian. But guess what? Oh my gosh, I just got this new Bible. I'm not even kidding. It came free, and I love free in my box. And I really think this is what you guys have to have in your classroom. Like, seriously, I've read like the first couple of chapters, and it's got pictures in it. I think you could use this. It's got questions in it, and I really think you guys could do well with that. That's what's going to be, that's contagious. So now you're going, I want to get on the floor with her. I want to follow her. That's what you want from your group of people, your people. You want to become family with them, and you have to remember on your worst day, regardless of your curriculum, regardless of your circumstance, they're here under the same circumstances that you are, and you have the ability to make or break their day. Then they're going to go in their classrooms, and they have the ability to make or break that kid's day. And I'll tell you, that relationship that you develop with your kid that morning might be the only adult attention that child will have all week. Mm-hmm. So you know what? Don't take it lightly. God has given us a task. God has given us material through curriculums. God has given us direction on how he wants us to lead our church. So if nothing I have said reflects my title, it was because that it all just does. It all just, the bottom line is, you need to have a curriculum that's gonna move your church in the direction that you wanna go. And you know you need to be making disciples for Christ. So you want your curriculum to be real, so you can stimulate all skills. You're reaching all sensory, and you're sending them out. They're gonna do a better job than you did. Thank you so much for coming, guys. You are awesome. Question?
Well, thank you. I think that reel is very, very handy.
Yes.
That's just because it's something you can really remember and just apply to any curriculum, because there's so much out there on the market.
Yeah.
For sure. If you Google, anybody's Google.
Yeah.
Yes. Christian Ed. So thank you. Yeah, that was very helpful. I did have a very practical question.
Yeah.
What is your budget?
Okay, so here's the cool thing. When I started, it was $3,000.
Okay.
And then over 13 years, so up to this September, it was $1,250. And then we got a new pastor, and we love him, but he's a number guy, and he's a business guy, and he said, we're not meeting our budget, and we haven't done that in 10 years.
Right.
So why have this vision kingdom vision budget when we're not maintaining it?
Mm-hmm.
So he said, we need to cut your hours. So I was 40 hours, and they wanted to cut me to 30. And I said, I'll tell you what, you can cut me 5, and I'll sacrifice half of my budget.
Okay.
So that being said, I do go around to other churches, and I facilitate churches who have budgets of $500, $200. We ran the biggest VBS in my little town with no budget, on the phone, donations, who's got what, getting stuff from community. It was amazing. So
how much would the Faith Weaver run about?
So Faith Weaver to run, okay, here's another beautiful thing. If you're gonna run one quarter of curriculum from infant to grade, it goes to grade 6, in the kits that I get. By the way, their kits come with everything. It's like pop open VBS. You've got your globe you blow up, you've got your posters, I brought one of my posters. You have, and I wanna give you guys these things. I thought we'd have more time. So really quickly, this just goes with the Ten Commandments. I would have the kids cut out their puzzles so that they can take it home and they can do it with their parents and tell their parents about these commandments. Here, I'll give you one too, because you're so awesome and you like Nike. So what was the question?
I don't know, I shouldn't say most churches, but I mean, for example, we've just got volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
So no paid staff for children's ministry, but just in terms of the curriculum, how much would the budget be for children's ministry without the salary?
Okay, so children's ministry, just for curriculum, for one quarter with Faith Weaver, for that age group, I'm looking at about $400 a quarter.
Okay.
Here's a wonderful thing. A lot of curriculums, and pay attention to this, ladies, if you're a money saver, because I am, most curriculums run on a 2-year cycle. Some of them are just starting to switch over, but my group does 3 years. So by the time a kid now is moving up, they haven't heard the story 2 or 3 times, right? So it's a 3-year. I'm in my recycle year, I should have brought a picture. I can email it to you. I've got a whole wall of curriculum because I don't throw anything out, and I'm recycling all my curriculum, so I don't have to buy a single thing, so the money that I've lost, I can focus on VBS, because that's the budget I cut, was my VBS budget. No more free VBS. I got to charge now. But, there's ways of doing it.
Yeah, okay.
And here's another thing too. Don't ever be afraid to fight for something that you believe in your ministry, because nobody else is doing your job, whether you're volunteer, paid. Nobody knows what you do. So when I sat down and said, you can't cut me 10 hours, you can cut me 5, but to take 40 hours out of my month, you'll have to hire somebody else to do that job now. Right? Stand up for yourself, fight for your budgets, or fight for your program. Right? And the power, I keep stepping on these rocks. Power is all yours. You have it. Advocate for it.
Well, I'm so happy to hear that there is a Sunday school with 135 kids in it. That is very inspiring.
Well, our average is maybe just around the 90 to, like, on a Sunday.
That's huge.
Yeah. It's so...
Ours was big, but that is...
Oh. I think it's not the smallest in our town, but like Faith Baptist is, they're at about 300 kids, right? So I always, they're like, you're my heroes, what are you guys doing over there? So, yeah.
It all comes, like the numbers come with issues, like the staffing and the
monster. Yeah. I just had a question. Do you bring in all of the kids together and then share the story?
No. So all of our kids start in our service with worship, because we want them to see their parents worshiping and learning the same songs their parents are, and groups, music. A lot of it is stuff that has been created for kids, but our hymns or choruses that we're singing in our service. So they're singing with their parents on the way home now. Then we want them to also see the element of tithing, so we have them participate, because we don't do children's... Leaving it up to parents now to give them their loony is not... It's not cutting it. Our numbers went down. We had to drop our compassion kid. It just wrecks things. So we want kids being trained by their parents now. Mm-hmm. So they do that. Congregational prayer. It's very important that our kids see our parents praying. Right after that, our kids are dismissed. Teachers are in their classrooms, and that's where they go to their designated classroom. Summertime, though, we do have children's church. So we'll have everybody come together and we do our own worship, because it's a little bit of a longer service, and because we get a lot of community kids. So they don't have a parent to sit with in the sanctuary, right? So they can come to the early children's church, and some other kids still prefer to go in and be dismissed. But yeah, that's where we're at. Yeah. Any other questions?
Do you have a blog?
I don't.
An email that we...
I have an email. Sure.
Thank you.
It's Michelle, MICHELLE, at fellowship-church. She's fast. .ca. So Michelle at fellowship-church.ca. And I do have Facebook, and I've got all that fun stuff. But I honestly, my thing is that I love to connect. So something that my church has been amazing with is allowing me to go out to churches that are like, we're closing down our midweek program because we just don't have volunteers, or our budget's out the window. We can't do VBS this year. Yes, you can. We can do it. Let's do it, right? And so get in the car, drive on out, and show me what you have. What do we have to work with? You got a lamp? Excellent. You got some boxes and chairs? Great, right? Let's do it. So connect if you want, if you have any questions or any questions about group material or anything like that. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
You guys are awesome.
Thank you so much.
You guys are so seriously awesome. Thank you for coming and standing out there and wondering what kind of that's going on here. And thanks for being crazy. I love it.
Thank you.
To be here today.
So I'm here till the end of lunch.
Okay.
So I'll be downstairs by the curriculum stuff. I will warn you, I don't know a whole lot about the curriculum that they sent me to show you guys, but there's a few that I have used over the years that I can talk about. And I'd love to chat with you.
Thank you. I'll catch you there.
I do. Right. Enjoy your lunch. It smells really good too. Oh, you know what? Can I pray?
Yeah.
Can I do that just really kind of like, okay. Father God, I just want to thank you for this great day. Lord, we come, the sun is shining, and coming to this beautiful church that was almost just, it was breathtaking. And being able to look around and seeing your creation is a reminder of what a creative, amazing God you are. God, you have brought this group together here today because they love children. They love to be, they know the responsibility, but they know that you said, let the little children come. And so God, following in your example, we just pray a blessing right now that you will bless all of our ministries, all of our volunteers, all of our leaders, Lord, that you will give us the gifts of discernment, that you will give us an understanding of the direction we want our churches to go. God, I pray for this whole group here, that the direction that they choose to take their churches in, one that honors you and glorifies you, one that makes disciples, and one that sends out even young people to bring the gospel. God, thank you again for this day now, and just bless the rest of our morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.